Hi everyone, this is Ezekiel O'Callaghan with Raptor Chatter, here to talk about what happened for July 2020 in paleontology. And there was a lot going on, so let's get into it. To start, it's not a paper that was published this month, but a paper that was redacted this month. A few months ago, I discussed a paper that mentioned what might be the smallest dinosaur on record, or at least in the fossil record. This paper, which talked about Occidentalavis, has been formally retracted from the journal Nature. And that's because a new specimen has shown up, which makes it much more likely that this isn't in fact a dinosaur. Instead, it's more likely that this is a lizard, and a new paper is being written and has actually gone into preprint, so some people can start to read the very first version of it already. While this may seem like the scientists aren't being consistent with their ideology, it actually shows just how science works, with different hypotheses being tested and retested in the light of new evidence. And shows just how key it is for the sciences to continually retest things, no matter how certain something seems after just one experiment or one paper. As for new publications, there was some new work coming in on pterosaurs, and specifically very, very young pterosaurs. The genus Rhamphorhynchus is very valuable to scientists because we have a wide number of specimens that represent a wide number of different ages. With this, researchers were able to establish more or less a consistent growth curve, showing that even the youngest known Rhamphorhynchids don't necessarily have wildly different proportions to those of the adults. This makes pterosaurs very, very strange for vertebrates, as unlike any of the modern vertebrates that we have that do fly, such as bats or birds, they likely were able to fly almost as soon as they hatch, which is again very unique. Another paper on pterosaurs came out that looked at their origins and the origins of dinosaurs. Specifically, a new fossil that was described and named as Conganophon Keeley. Conganophon Keeley has been shown to be very closely related to the origins of both the dinosaurs and the pterosaurs, and multiple different analyses were run to see which one of these it was closer to, with it showing up closer to each of these different groups depending on which species were used in the overall analysis. Conganophon Keeley helps to show that the earliest ornithoderans, the clade that includes both the dinosaurs and the pterosaurs, would have started out very small, and this very small size would have helped both clades to succeed. In the dinosaur lineage, it would have helped them to become more bipedal, something that would have been an advantage over many of the pseudosuchians which existed at the same time during the Triassic. In the pterosaurs, this small size would have likely led them to be more able to fly, as having a smaller size and less weight does make it easier to lift oneself into the air. And so, as small as Conganophon might be, it does help to show how that small size did lead to the massive successes of both the pterosaurs and the dinosaurs. Another paper looked more specifically at just the origins of the dinosaurs, and specifically with many of the very early dinosaur fossils coming from South America. What the fossils suggest, specifically with Pisanosaurus, is that the more traditional family breakup of the dinosaurs is correct, with Saurischia and Ornithischia. Recently, a few years ago, a paper came out which suggested that this wasn't necessarily the case, and that the dinosaur family tree actually looked more like this, with the Ornithischians and theropod dinosaurs being placed together and the sauropods laying as an outgroup. However, these fossils coming from South America, and again specifically Pisanosaurus, which was recovered as the oldest Ornithischian, suggests that this isn't the case, and that the more traditional view of dinosaurs is the correct one, at least based on the current evidence. Another paper looked at just the evolution of sauropodomorpha, which doesn't include just the sauropods, but also many non-sauropods, something that was formerly called prosauropods, included in the group, things like Plateosaurus or Buriolestes. In the last 10 years, there's been a lot of discovery in this field with the sauropods, and so this paper tried to analyze all of the different sauropods, including many of the new ones, and we're trying to get a better understanding of how exactly the different clades evolved. With 307 different taxa included, the family tree that was found looks something like this. They were also able to analyze how complete many of the specimens were, with many of the Cretaceous genera being very, very partial, but having enough material there to identify them as being unrelated or at least distantly related instead of the same genus. Now, these Cretaceous specimens being more partial is something that the authors don't exactly have an explanation for, especially with many of the Jurassic taxon being very similarly sized. It could potentially just be biases in where the animals lived, leading to less of the animal being preserved and buried to be saved in the fossil record. There could be other things, depending on what kind of animals were predating on them, leading to less fossils being able to be preserved, or even environmental biases that may have not just left as many fossils there in the first place, even if they were buried. The authors also are deliberate to point out that this kind of study that takes out an entire clade of animals in very great detail, with the history of the animals, with the different taxon and when they were named also being included, and how that helped shape our understanding of the clade, is going to be very important in the near future. As sciences and paleontology continue to get more complicated, with more people going out and doing research, and how having very large papers like this that contain an entire clade very, very specifically focused down can help us understand exactly what is going on in the fossil record. As for the new finds of the last 10 years, they don't seem likely to slow down, with two new species coming, one from Switzerland, Schlothemia schultzi. Based on the bones of this animal, it was very, very close to the true sauropods, not being more closely related to what was again called the prosauropods previously. What this suggests is that the sauropods and many of the various sauropodomorphs that were not sauropods were able to make it into the late Triassic and potentially even exceed beyond it, as the next fossil also shows, coming from China. Irisosaurus yemenensis is one of the 13 clades of sauropodomorphs that made it into the early Jurassic, but only one of those clades would develop into the true sauropods, and Irisosaurus wasn't one of those, although it was incredibly, incredibly close. Phylogenetically, Irisosaurus pairs very closely with the Argentine taxon, Musasaurus, and is also relatively close and separated from other Chinese species by only one North American genus, Cytad. What this indicates is that this specific clade was actually very successful throughout the late Triassic and the early Jurassic, and would have likely been much more likely to succeed had it not been for the true sauropods rise to power during the middle Jurassic, something which we need to study in greater detail to understand exactly what the differences were that led to the true sauropods becoming as successful as they were, and animals like Irisosaurus dying out. While this location doesn't have a lot of known sauropodomorphs coming from it, it does have a lot of fossils from around the same time period, and that's the Petrified Forest, which has been dated in even greater detail than it has been previously. In order to date the Triassic formations that are around Petrified Forest, core samples were taken, and the youngest zircon crystals were analyzed in order to find their age. Zircon has uranium, which decays and can be used for radiometric dating in order to understand how old the rock is. Unfortunately, that only shows when that zircon crystal formed, and not necessarily when the deposits that have and contain the zircon were actually laid down. However, by finding the youngest occurrence of zircon within a single rock layer, what we're able to do is say that this deposit must be at least younger than this and cannot be any older than it. So for example, in the Moenkopi Formation, which is known for animals like Arizonosaurus, the youngest zircon tracked at about 241 million years old, meaning that the top layer of the Moenkopi must be younger than that, or about that old to be more realistic in what we can expect it to be, more certainly. As for the Chile Formation, which makes up the bulk of Petrified Forest, those rocks were dated between 222 million years ago to about 213.5 million years ago, which is slightly shorter than might have been expected, and helps to indicate that there may have been a significant faunal changeover during the Norian, different tectonic events pulling apart Pangaea and certain mountain building events to the south of Petrified Forest could have changed the climate, making it more arid as there was a rain shadow effect coming from the more equatorial regions to the south that was blocked by these new mountains. It will take further analysis for us to understand exactly what kind of impact these changes had on the life at Petrified Forest. However, with so many abundant fossils occurring at the location, it's not unlikely that we'll have much better studies in the not-too-distant future, and so hopefully we'll be able to get a better idea of how exactly paleoclimate affected what is one of the most beautiful places and one of the most interesting places for paleontology in the United States. As for the area just outside of the Petrified Forest, we have parts of the Kayenta Formation, which are actually from the early Jurassic, and contain one of the most iconic dinosaurs of all time, Dilophosaurus. Dilophosaurus, over the last 30 or so years, has become a very iconic species, mainly because of its appearance in Jurassic Park, where it attacks and kills Wayne Knight. However, that exact depiction isn't completely accurate, and a new study helps to show exactly that. The study is a monograph, meaning that it essentially takes as much detail as it can into just one specific taxon and helps to organize exactly what it was, what it would have looked like, and takes very specific measurements on many of the bones. The new paper looked at Dilophosaurus in incredible, incredible detail, and helps to show many new features and many things that were formerly thought may not actually be entirely correct. For example, it helps to show that the crests that would have been on top of Dilophosaurus's head were actually probably hollow, as they were connected to the sinuses, and may have been covered in some kind of keratin to help increase their size and help them be even larger than they may have appeared, but also help them to use some kind of resonant system to help make more broader calls. And this is something that isn't entirely unlikely, especially when you look at many modern birds, such as hornbills, which have a very similar system in place in the modern day. The study also found that because of how the fossils were prepared, the assumptions we had made about Dilophosaurus's bite strength were also incorrect. Because the researchers at UC Berkeley wanted to have the entire animal in perfect display, they used some parts of plaster to help fill out some of the bone. And while it was still good for study for many, many years, when we're getting down to the specific minutiae of a specific taxon, it helps to make sure you have exactly what it was when it came out of the rock. And so by understanding what parts are plaster, what parts aren't, researchers were able to find that it actually would have had a much stronger bite force than previously thought. And so instead of having a much weaker bite force and probably going after small animals as it was previously thought, it's much more likely that Dilophosaurus was very much an apex predator. And while it didn't likely have poison like in Jurassic Park, it very well would have still been able to mess up anything our size, if not larger. In fact, there are teeth marks and Dilophosaurus teeth around the fossils of an animal called Saurosaurus, which was one of these early sauropodomorphs, and helps to show that Dilophosaurus very much could handle its own, even against very large prey. I do want to mention that I had a blog post on our website about this paper, so you can go there for more detail, or even go directly to the source, as the lead author, Adam Marsh, made deliberate care to make sure that this paper would be open access so that all people could read it. A large part of his decision to make this open access comes from the fact that all of these fossils come from Native American lands, and there's been a long history of colonialism relating to paleontology, and trying to end that tradition is something that is very important, so that we can try and have a more inclusive and more complete understanding of how exactly these fossils relate with society. While we do have a new understanding of how Dilophosaurus may have behaved, we also have some evidence that certain animals didn't behave all that differently than they do today. Coming from the Mygatt Moor quarry in the Jurassic Morrison Formation, evidence shows that there were different beetles and other animals, and bugs specifically, feeding on the dead animals that would eventually become preserved in the fossil record. While this seems very unlikely, many of these were predator traps, meaning the animals wouldn't have been touched by many other animals and getting more destroyed that way, as any other animal that came out to try and feed would have also itself become stuck. What this means is that they would have been exposed, and these different kinds of insects, such as the beetles, would have been able to land, lay eggs, and leave. It then would have taken a long amount of time for those eggs to hatch, feed, and then also grow up and leave. With this, we're able to understand exactly how long these different animals might have been exposed at the surface before they were finally buried and able to be preserved in the fossil record. By comparing this to modern species, it's been estimated that these fossils were exposed at the surface for at least 17 weeks, which is quite a prolonged amount of time when you consider how quickly most fossils need to be buried in order to be preserved, and just goes to show how unique the situation at the different quarries in the Morrison Formation were, and just how lucky we are to be here at the right time and having people in the right places to find them. As for those quarries, Allosaurus is one of the most common animals coming out of them. However, at the same time in Europe, there was a different kind of fauna starting to develop. The first describable fossil of a Jurassic Carcharodontosaur has been described and dubbed Lusovenator santosi. Now, this find coming from Portugal isn't entirely surprising, and a large part of that is because the site coming in Portugal has shown to produce different Carcharodontosaur teeth over time before. However, it does help us to narrow down exactly how these different clades may have been able to become so successful, especially as they were, again, quite successful, especially in the early Cretaceous, where they were the dominant predator in North America, Africa, and large parts of South America. And while Europe has a slightly weaker record here, it's safe to say they were probably fairly dominant there too, at least for a time. Hopefully more work will also be done with this fossil to understand where exactly it falls into the dinosaur family tree, and especially where the carcharodontosaurs were able to evolve out of the allosauroids, and exactly how closely related they may be to Allosaurus. The carcharodontosaurs were able to become much more dominant from the transition from the Jurassic into the Cretaceous. However, they weren't the only clade to become wildly successful during this time period. For example, the Pachycephalosaurs first show up during the Cretaceous, or so it was thought. A new study looking at the different phylogenies of the entire Ornithischian tree helps to suggest that the heterodontosaurs were actually very, very primitive and basal Pachycephalosaurs. What this does is help to extend back the family tree of Pachycephalosaurs at least into the Jurassic, if not the Triassic. It also helps to suggest that there weren't as many wild diversification events happening with the dinosaurs, at least to some degree. Certainly the Pachycephalosaurs had to undergo a major change from the heterodontosaurs to become what they were, especially with those large domed heads. However, it's not like they were arising out of some previously unknown lineage. Instead, we have that lineage, and we have a good record of that lineage. This kind of study helps to illustrate why it's so important to go back and look at many of the fossils and different taxon that we have already found and described, and compare them with a lot of different features, because otherwise this study probably wouldn't have been likely to pick up the heterodontosaurs as very primitive Pachycephalosaurs. But instead, with this study, we're able to better understand how exactly the dinosaurs were able to evolve over millions and millions of years. One place with Pachycephalosaur dinosaurs is the Prince Creek Formation of Alaska, which also preserves some of the northernmost dinosaurs, and we also now have the northernmost juvenile dromaeosaur. While teeth from dromaeosaurs have been found in the Prince Creek Formation before, this is the first part of the jawline as well, which helps again to indicate that this is a juvenile animal. And being a juvenile, it would have been much less adapted and ready for long migrations. Instead, it's been suggested that if these animals were migrating, it would be to the south to lay eggs, and then migrating back north to feed as the seasons warmed up. Because this is a juvenile so far north, it's far, far more likely that they weren't migrating at all. And instead, these animals were staying in the north and the polar region, even above the Arctic Circle, full time, rather than migrating southwards in order to try and find better temperatures. Next, we have a few animals which have been known to science but only recently formally described. The first is an Oligocene dolphin, Ankyloriza tiedemanni. Ankyloriza was very likely a macro predator within the water column, hunting for relatively large prey, much like the modern orca, which itself is a dolphin, despite the name killer whale. However, Ankyloriza wasn't directly related to the killer whale. Instead, it was a separate lineage, which happened to convergently evolve many of the same adaptations, despite not, again, directly leading into the orca. Additionally, the name Ankyloriza helped to show one of these adaptations, the fused roots in the teeth. Many primitive whales still had two separate roots in the teeth, and Ankyloriza does have just the one, meaning they fused together in order to give a more permanent socket and grip in the jaws so that they could go after larger prey. There are also a few other adaptations that are mentioned in this paper that help to show that it had a lot of convergent evolution with orcas, such as certain bones being shortened. However, it does also show how even tens of millions of years ago in the Oligocene, many of the current niches that are filled by many of the whales are already being filled even by very primitive and early whales. The other fossil that has already been known to science and even been used in phylogenetic studies because it's so well preserved is Collinsovermis monstrosus. When it was first found in the 1970s, no one really knew what it was at that time, and that's a large part of the reason why it's taken so long for it to be formally described. However, as we continue to find new fossils, even up until the modern day, one of the clades of Lobopodons helped to show that that's exactly what it was, a Lobopodon. And because it was so well preserved, even without being documented formally, it was able to be used as just a specimen number in many of these phylogenetic analyses. This new paper that describes it formally also uses it in phylogenetic analysis, and finds it in the same place that many of these previous papers that used it found it in, meaning that they were still fairly accurate even though the animal wasn't formally described yet. However, having all of these details formally written down can help, just in case the specimen is ever lost for some reason. However, hopefully that will become far less likely, as many museums are being much more careful than they were in the past about documenting different specimens and keeping them on track. Now that it has been formally described, though, hopefully will help us understand a little bit more of what was happening in the Cambrian, especially as there are different formations that have somewhat similar but also very different types of life, such as some of the Chinese Lagerstättens and the Burgess Shale, where Collinsovermes is from. And finally, the last of the animals that have been known to science but only recently formally described was also the last of the alvarosaurs, which were incredibly strange dinosaurs with just a single large claw on each hand. This would have been the very last of them coming from the Hell Creek Formation of Montana, the same formation that animals like Tyrannosaurus rex are found in, and that is essentially cut off by the impact that killed the dinosaurs, or at least the non-avian dinosaurs. Triarchicus pruriensis has enough fossils to form a growth pattern, at least of the hand, and it also helps to suggest that of the alvarosaurs, their hand claws could become significantly more curved than previously thought. The growth pattern also suggests a reason for this, that many of the other fossils we have of alvarosaurs may actually just be juveniles, and Triarchicus was at least slightly larger than these other ones, although it was still fairly small, even by dinosaur standards. This study also opens the possibility that Triarchicus may have been behaving slightly differently than the other alvarosaurs. However, we first need to try and understand how they might have been behaving in the first place, as these are still, again, very bizarre animals, and we're not exactly sure what they were doing, although they were seemingly very successful. As the last of the alvarosaurs, Triarchicus would have seen the impact that killed the non-avian dinosaurs. However, a new study also suggests that many of the different climatic events that occurred in Earth's history probably weren't due to impacts. A new study specifically looks at the Younger Dryas period, which has been suggested to have occurred for many different reasons. It was a sudden cooling period during the Ice Ages, which had a very cyclical warming and cooling before this point. Two main competing ideas have been proposed for this cooling. One is that there was an impact from space, and the debris that was launched from this impact helped to shade the planet and cause the sudden cooling. The other was essentially that this cooling and the stuff that was in the atmosphere that helped to shade the planet was from massive volcanoes. However, where those exactly were isn't necessarily nailed down for certain yet. Many heavy metals were found within a core sample coming from Texas, which could indicate either one of these different hypotheses. However, the heavy metals were found occurring over a period of about 4,000 years, which an impact doesn't take place over 4,000 years. It takes place over a much, much smaller interval of even just a few seconds for the impact itself, with the debris falling out over a few hundred years after that. But not 4,000. This is much more indicative of heavy magmatic and volcanic activity happening during the Younger Dryas period, and makes it much more likely that this major cooling event occurred because of volcanic activity and not an impact from space. Hi everyone, thanks for watching. School started. Yay! You can't just say people need to stay inside, so be as safe as you can. Wear masks, wash hands, don't go out unless you really need to. Hopefully there's at least good walking around where you are so you can get out and, you know, see the world a bit, but not necessarily in a large group. There was also another paper I want to mention that was a letter in Nature that I'm going to link below that talked about how geology as a study represents and interacts with society and specifically the Black Lives Matter movement and specifically Black women. And I am not the person best suited to comment on that, but it is there. Anyway, you know, be safe, take care, wash your hands, wear a mask, don't go extinct.